Good morning, everybody. I feel the excitement. Happy Resurrection Sunday. If you're not, yeah, give him a whoop. If you're not in your seats, shimmy on down. If you are in your seats, shimmy on up. We're going to stand before we go into worship this morning. I want to say good morning to everybody who's online. Hello. It's so beautiful that we get to connect with you guys, especially. Hoping the right camera's there. So hello, hello. We love you guys. If you're new, good morning to you guys as well. Give you guys a special wave. I'm Matt, one of the pastors here, and it's beautiful to meet you, to be with you whilst we worship, and we'd love to connect after the service. So now that we're all ready, prepped, and stood, can I read a verse to you before we worship? Yes. Should we get some word into us? So I'm in 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm going to read verse 3 and maybe verse 4 and 5. So I'd love for us first to just close our eyes, center ourselves on the presence of God. You know, the veil is torn, so we get easy access. Easy, easy access. You don't have to strive to get into the holiest of holies. And just hear this morning. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. I'm going to read that again. Blessed be you, Father. Blessed be you, Abba, Father of Jesus Christ, who through your abundant mercy, Lord, through your abundant mercy begot me, begot everybody in this room into a living hope. We thank you this morning that hope is alive, that in the midst of all of the world, in the midst of all of ourselves, that hope is alive and breathing. That hope did not stay dead in the grave, but hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead brings us to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away. It is reserved in heaven for you who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Lord, we are so honored this morning for the gift of remembering you, the gift of remembering your resurrection and being reminded afresh that hope is alive. So we honor you this morning. We put you at the center of all of our thinking and doing, and we bring to you an offering of worship that says he is alive and he is worthy. He is alive and he is worthy. Say that with me. He is alive and he is worthy. Amen.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive. I hold the keys to death and Hades.
your own words. Let's lift up thanksgiving this morning.
Thank you, Lord. Jesus Christ. Oh,
you've done. The power of your blood was more than enough for the cross. What you've done was more than enough, more than enough for the cross. What you've done, the power of your blood was more than enough.
Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You know, there's an invitation to each and every person in this room today, every one of you online, to come to a garden of encounter. Jesus manifested his resurrected body first in the garden, introduced himself to a woman who knew him but didn't see him, because he was resurrected and perfected through the healing presence of the Holy Spirit that took the scars, the bruising, the abuse upon his body and made him new and resurrected him. And it all started in the garden in a good way. And it all went wrong in a bad way in the garden. God set up a temple on the earth that says, I want to relate to you. I want to bring you into fellowship. He walked in the garden in the cool of the day, in the morning, in the evening, to fellowship, to bring us into a place of communion. It was God's pattern. It was God's design right from the beginning. He wanted to populate the earth with worshippers. And the cruelty is this, that a living tree was defiled by humanity, by its touch and its irreverence. And then a human designed tree, a cross, was touched by the perfected, sinless Savior, Jesus Christ. It's a lovely exchange. What was perfect, what was living, what was alive, was touched by our humanity, and sin entered into the world. And then mankind, through its error, its sin, created its own method, its own tree, its human design tree. And Jesus bore our sin because he wanted to bring us into a garden of relationship and fellowship. And that's the wonder of the resurrection. And it's where the book ends. It starts in Genesis with intimacy that looks like a temple without walls, without structure, without form, the cool of the day. Relating, talking, communing in relationship. And it ends there in the book of Revelation that says, yes, there is a city that has walls because God's into boundaries. He creates riverbanks. His life flows through rivers from his throne. He's into boundaries. He's into stuff that works for him. That's what the Ten Commandments are about. God's boundaries, God's best way of living for us that keeps us safe and keeps us in his life and in his love. And it ends there, this wonderful city descends in the book of Revelation where the light of the world is Jesus the Lamb. He is the lamp in that city. He is its temple. It's a living, relating, knowable, huggable, come close to temple of God. So Lord, we thank you for your presence here. We thank you for the resurrection of Jesus. We thank you for a garden of hope. And I pray for each and every heart in this room today that we would discover your love, your resurrected, conquering love that deals with every issue of shame, sin, separation, death, judgment, cancels it all out. So I'm going to encourage you to open up your heart to him today, to stay open. I'm going to lead you in a few moments into letting the Bible speak for itself and tell its story of from death to resurrection. But just take your seats for a moment. We've got practical things to do. Churches have to do practical stuff. Like tell you what's happening. And my first job is to say very, very warm welcome here to Adore Church, especially if you're here for the first time. We're delighted you're here with us. For those who are friends, family of Jamal, who's getting baptized today. Yeah. You can tell we love him. And we're excited. We're excited for this moment in his journey. I'm also gonna say as well, if there are others who've come here today thinking, I wanna give my life to Jesus. I might have or might not got a change of clothes, but I want to get into the water and give my life to him. We're going to open up that space for you a little bit later too. But Jamal, you've already signed up. He's prepared. He's good to go, which we're excited about. So a couple of things. Our host team are going to pass around our offering tins. A QR code is going to appear on the screen if you want to give that way. Or we have a contactless payment reader in the lobby area. I actually came across, we get a little report of people who attempt to make payments. We had somebody try and pay in £1 million this week. I don't know who you are. You've tried a couple of times, but it ain't working. But I'm praying that God will bless you to the point that one day you'll tap, you'll put your card in, and you'll have all the money there to put £1 million in, because we need it. It'll be great for our redevelopments. Anyway, a couple of things to mention. As a church community, we are having a family weekend away in the summer over August, bank holiday weekend. It's David's Tent. It's an established event. There are several thousand, 4,000 or 5,000 people who go to it. It's got children's program, youth program. It's got a wonderful worship space, 72 hours of nonstop worship. They don't expect you to be there for the whole 72 hours. You are allowed to sleep, whether that's on-site or off-site. And we're creating a space for us to just do family, do church together, to hang out. It's all laid up for us, so it's kind of low impact in terms of demand upon us to make stuff happen. We just turn up to a really well-run event and just enjoy the presence of God and fellowship with each other. Today is 10% discount day, final day. So after today, if you book in, prices are going to bump up a little bit. So I want to encourage you, it's the last weekend in August. Church won't be happening here, and we'll be down there in Malmesbury in Wiltshire. So we'd love you to come along and be a part of that. The other thing I want to mention is we've got a conference happening here on April the 13th. Really important. It's Christian Concern. It's a state of the nation. It's a kind of create an awareness about what is going on in our nation and how can we respond to it. How can we have reason and argument and strength and conviction and courage and compassion to meet the world with a message of hope, the gospel. So it's going to address all the issues that are being stirred up in our nation. Really need to be there, guys. Get signed up. It's £15. See it as worship. See it as an offering. We don't make money on any of our conferences. Never have. We put money into the ministries that come into this place. We're going to cover basic costs. It includes a lunch. It gives you time to fellowship and connect over the lunchtime. But we want to bless Christian Concern because they do a unique and amazing job representing faith in our nation with courage and confidence and boldness. People are losing their jobs because they dare to speak about Jesus and their faith, and to evidence that in workplace, in school, in education, in all sorts of streams and stratas of life. So I want to encourage you, it will inform you, it will inspire you, it will equip you, it will enable you and give you hope for what God is doing in our day and our time. Selwyn's going to join me up the front here just to give me some accompaniment, because yeah, we love Selwyn and his beautiful wife Pauline sat in the front row here as well. But what I want to do today is just lead you through, before we get to the baptisms, just Psalms in the Old Testament that tell the story. And my heart into coming in today is not to bring you a clever Resurrection Sunday message, but just to lead you through to an encounter and a response to Jesus. So I'm going to ask some things of you. So if you're new into kind of faith in this type of space, do not feel persuaded or coerced into doing anything. I want this to be voluntary. But there were three movements within these Psalms, Psalm 22, Psalm 23, and Psalm 24. And they take us through the weekend. They take us through the agony of the cross. They bring us into that waiting place, anticipating resurrection in Psalm 23. And they bring us to Psalm 24, which is a psalm about the resurrected King. But there's something in all of it, in all of these Psalms, for us to step into and to gain the benefit and strengthen our own faith from. So the postures are going to be these. In Psalm 22, as I read it and as we read it together, my response is to kneel. Because there's a description of Jesus prophetically in that Psalm of the cross. There are 17 verses that create 13 direct connections to the crucifixion. Stunning. And people say it kind of got a little bit wrong for Jesus and he got a bit out of control and he ended up there. No, no, no. It was intricately designed and purposed by God, buried in the Old Testament, saying, this is happening. This is the way. This is the way to redemption. And it's a beautiful, beautiful psalm. But as I read it, and I want to encourage you to stay in a place of worship and response. That's all I want to steward in this space today before we baptize Jamal and any others. Is to say, let's just love him. Let's give him our undivided heart, focus, attention as we journey through these Psalms. And there's a call in Psalm 24 when we get there. For you and I, if we're following Jesus, this is how he calls us to live. There's an invitation to stewarding our hands, our what we touch, our resources and our hearts. Those are the ones who ascend into the Lord's presence, who have clean hands and a pure heart. There's an invitation to be ones who open the door through our life, through our surrender, to reveal his glory and his majesty and his power. It's wonderful. And there's a shepherding journey in Psalm 23, familiar psalm to many of us. But there's something around the waiting and being in the valley, being in that place where it's challenging. There's an invitation from Jesus where he sets a table before us. And in that moment in Psalm 23, we're going to invite you to take and share communion. So I'm going to suggest to you, and I want this to be voluntary, okay? But I want you to be free to choose. We don't like you to feel stuck in your seats and your rows and your chairs. It's just easier to give you a place to sit and be here among us. But I want to encourage you to kneel during Psalm 22, to sit during Psalm 23, and to stand during Psalm 24. There's a posture, there's a progression. So in the revelation of the cross, what can we stand? When Jesus poured his life out, when you read the words, they're powerful, they are gripping. So Psalm 22 is about Jesus' death, and it's prophetic. He is our prophet, he is our priest, he is our king. And they go through that flow. There's a prophetic moment where God opens up in the scriptures and says, this is the one who's going to surrender his life. There's a prophetic message. It is priestly in Psalm 23. It's that burial. He's the good shepherd who leads us through a valley. He leads us to bubbling brooks of bliss and to green pasture and to a place of connection. And in the midst of turmoil and all the rest of it, threat and enemy and opposition, he says, I've got a place for you to sit down and to receive me. And when it comes through to Psalm 24, it's about resurrection. It's about the one who is revealed as majesty, the majestic one. It is exactly the same as the incarnation. The Magi came from the east and they brought gifts, didn't they? They brought myrrh, symbolic of death, prophetic of a death. They brought a gift of frankincense, incense, priestly. He is a priest. And they brought gifts of gold. He is a king. It's echoed in this same moment. So I'm going to read Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me, they wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord, let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, for he delights in him. Yet you are he who took me from the womb. You made me trust you at my mother's breasts. On you was I cast from my birth, and from my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Many bulls encompass me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me, like a ravening and roaring lion. For I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs encompass me. A company of evildoers encircles me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them. And for my clothing, they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far off. O you, my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. You have rescued me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him and stand in awe of him. All you offspring of Israel. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, and he has not hidden his face from him, but has heard when he cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will perform before those who fear him. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations shall worship before you. For kingship belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the prosperous of the earth eat and worship. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, even the one who could not keep himself alive. Posterity shall serve him. It shall be told of the Lord to the coming generation. They shall come and proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn, that he has done it. That he has done it. He's done it all. It is finished, was the cry of Jesus from the cross. If you want to sit, we're going to read Psalm 23. And as we do this, our host team are just going to bring pre-filled communion cups to where you're sat. I just want to encourage you just to open it and get that ready as we share this together. You know, we get to walk with him in life's valleys. He's there, he's revealing himself as the good shepherd. He is a priest to us. He leads, he guides, he serves, he ministers. It's very simple, the invitation. He leads, we follow. He leads, we follow. There's a wonderful moment in the middle of this psalm where he sits with us and he nourishes us. He brings us strength and sustenance to get us through the valley. You pass through a valley. He moves you through. You don't park up, you don't stay. You don't pitch your tent and say, I'm just in the valley. Because he is leading, he's a good shepherd. And every season of life that looks like difficulty, that looks like challenge, that looks like obstacle, you can be confident the chief and the good shepherd is a priest to you to direct that and turn it into worship. When we're a priest, we offer worship to him. We take on a priestly calling and a mandate. We're called a kingdom and nation of priests. I don't wear a dog collar and I never will. Never have, never will. Because there's a leveling here around priesthood, that we are a priesthood of all believers. We get to minister to him. We get to love him. So let's listen as we read these verses. And if you are in a valley and a time of testing, I want you to hear the Good Shepherd speaking into your circumstance, your situation right now. And he wants to open up to you a warfare strategy that looks very different, that looks like sitting. He says, in the presence of my enemies, I prepare a table for you. God prepared a table before we were born into this world, before the whole thing started. So before the foundations of the earth, he was given prophetically in the heart of God, the substitute, the table, the bread, the body, the wine, the blood. So let him feed you today. For the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. You know, the shepherd is always leading us to pasture. He's one who feeds our soul, satisfies our thirst and our longing. Everything else is a substitute, sells people short. It's the same when Jesus encountered the woman at the well. So I'm going to give you a drink. That means you'll never thirst again. This will completely satisfy you. My sense for some today in the room, there is an invitation to take that drink, to taste that goodness, and to let it relegate every other appetite, every other desire, even if it's an addiction, and to say there's a greater power, and that's tasting the Lord's goodness. There are literally multiple testimonies in this room of people who've encountered that love that has switched things around on the inside, changed appetites, changed desires. He's made you to love him, to receive his love, to give love back to him. It says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Sometimes we need the shepherd's staff that just pulls us in when we get ourselves in a bit of trouble. Sometimes we need a rod that's going to strike an enemy, somebody prowling, something that's coming against you. And he holds both of those things. You can do both. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows. So just in this moment, just take those elements to represent his body and his blood. Let it become in your spirit as you add your yes and your amen. Let it become a feast that strengthens you. So we take the wafer as a symbol of your body, Lord Jesus, given for us, broken for us. And we receive its nourishment, its healing. I just want to pray, just a prayer across the room today and online for just the healing presence of Jesus to manifest. So if you've got something going on in your body right now that's an affliction or an illness, whether it's been long-term or just something that's very recent, just open up your hands just to receive his healing presence. It's Resurrection Sunday. He's here with power to heal, to restore, to transform. Let's drink together the cup of his suffering, the cup of his yes, his obedient yes to the plan and design and will of God. And let's add our yes to his surrender, that his blood for you would cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Come, Lord Jesus, Chief Shepherd. His power and his blood, because it is eternal. It is without beginning, without end. Covers it all. Thank you, Jesus. So surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He's moving you through a valley because he's bringing you to a dwelling place, a house where you will live with him forever, where goodness and mercy will pursue you and chase you down. Thank you, Lord. So I'm going to invite you to stand as we read Psalm 24. So we've journeyed from death to waiting. This is Resurrection Day. This is a revealing of his glory. And what it does, it creates a picture for us of life in the power of the Holy Spirit. This is the other side. This is what he's leading you into. This is where he's taking you. He wants us to be carriers of glory and presence. It's the thing we're most hungry for here in Adore Church, is that we carry his presence, that you carry his presence. You become a vessel through which people look and bump into you and say, hey, there's something different about you. Carry something that's bringing hope into the room. And it's because of him. So the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The world and those who dwell therein, for he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. So who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? Now you need to hear that he wants you to get there. He wants you to stand. He wants us to ascend. God's desire and heart for you is that you ascend. I can't tell you how many times people have said in these spaces that my spirit is lifted. I feel encouragement. I feel strength. That is God's design for you, to ascend. He wants you to live a life where you feel that pull, that upward call of God in Christ Jesus on your heart, that you're not weighed down in a valley of despair. It's a manifestation of hope. We are hope bringers. We are hope carriers. It is the mystery of the gospel, Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is a glory psalm, and we carry glory. So who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? It is he who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully. God's into truth. If there's anything, parents in the room, that you teach your kids, is teach them to be honest and teach them to be truthful, even if it's uncomfortable. Even if it's uncomfortable. And you and I get to steward that. Why? Because it mirrors the nature, the core nature and revelation of God. He is truth. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And he talked about somebody else who was the father of lies. Don't want to utter his name in this place, in this moment. But truthfulness is so important. Honesty, truthfulness. It's there right in that psalm. Gets you into his presence. Those who do not lift up their souls to what is false and do not swear deceitfully, those are the people who will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. It's what it's all about. It's about seeking him, seeking his face. That's the revelation in the garden, That's the revelation in the book of Revelation at the end. It's beholding the Lamb. It's seeing the one. Seeing his face. So lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. So lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. And who is this King of glory? It is the Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. So you and I are gates. We are gates into the world of his presence. And if you take Psalm 23 and the anointing oil, it will let you know you don't need to be a creaky gate. The world's seen too many creaky gates that are making a noise that doesn't represent him. Our message is Jesus and him alone. So let's get some oil on the gates. Just open up your hands, receive his presence. Come, precious Holy Spirit. And just on this Resurrection Sunday, purpose in your heart to be one who reveals his glory, that you would open up your life, you would open up who you are to the world around you, to make him known, to tell his story. So Jesus, we just lift our hands in your presence. And we confess our love for you. If this is a first moment of confession, you just simply need to surrender and say, Jesus, I'm handing it all over. I'm getting out of the way and I'm putting you at the center. Just want the rest of the worship team just to come back up to the front. We're going to get ready to do our baptisms, and we're going to continue in a worship response that will flow out of that time. So Lord, we thank you for your love, for your goodness, for your presence, for your majesty, that you are prophet, that you are priest, that you are king. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. Okay, take your seats. Our host team are just going to clear a little bit of space here and move the lid on the hot tub. I want to welcome Jamal. Where is he? He's gone to the loo. That's fine, that's fine. We'll give him a big round of applause when he comes back in, yeah? Yeah, thank you, thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Get down there. He's coming through another door. He's going to surprise you. It's not that one. Jamal, come on through. Okay, Jamal, this is your moment. We want to hear some of your story. Some of what's brought you to this day and this decision.
Sorry.
To follow Jesus. So tell us in your own words, some of your story, some of your testimony, some of your why we're at this point today.
Okay. I'd say my auntie was an inspiration to me and my siblings. She was a devoted woman of God. Her strong faith had led me to make this decision to get baptized and be a good example to my daughter.
That's fantastic, Jamal. So what would you say in your relationship and journey with Jesus has been the most impacting thing for you that he's done for you?
Okay. Bishop, can you come to the front, please? Okay, Bishop Herbert has been has seen me grow up from a young man to where I am now. The encouragement, the words that he's given me, the prayer that's gone up, because he'd been looking forward to this moment for a very long time.
True or not? So true, Jamal.
Thank you. So I thought today's the day to go in the water.
That's fantastic. I'm going to invite us all to stand because we're bearing witness to this as friends and family. Those who want to get a little bit closer, close friends, family, you're welcome to just press in a little bit, move your way around, bring your cameras. We'll take some good photos that will circulate a little bit later. But I just need to just do some things with Jamal by way of confession, just to ask you three simple questions. I'm looking for three positive yeses, okay? So, Jamal, do you confess the Lord Jesus Christ as both your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Jamal, do you turn away from everything you know to be wrong or sinful?
Yes.
And Jamal, do you promise to follow Jesus with the power of the Holy Spirit all the days of your life?
I do.
Fantastic. Amen. Amen. Okay, Jono and Dan are just going to help you just get into the baptistry. We've got some steps just there. You want to bring those, Dan? We're really kind when it comes to baptisms because we heat the water nice to about 38 degrees. I've been in a few cold baptistries that by the end of a few have left me virtually hypothermic. But this is a good way to do it. Just while we're getting ready and prepared, I want to encourage you just to be praying if you're part of this church family, your friends and family, just for this to be a powerful, prophetic moment where Jamal gets touched by the Holy Spirit. We're praying for just that wonderful voice from heaven to speak into his heart. You know, when Jesus was baptized by John in the River Jordan, there's a lovely moment where the Holy Spirit descends upon him in bodily form as a dove. And there are two things in play that happen there, that God wants to touch our lives with his presence, that we feel and encounter his love. Christianity and following Jesus is more than ideology. It is more than rule, ritual, regulation. It is encounter. It is relationship. And that beautiful moment that Jesus had in the river with the Father just touching him through the Holy Spirit, creating presence and connection and affirmation, meaningful touch. We borrowed some of the language of, you know, love languages, but there was also prophetic. There was voice. There was communication into the heart that affirmed love and destiny and purpose. And we want to pray and extend a hand towards Jamal that he will hear the whisper, the voice of the Holy Spirit, bringing to life investment. We honor the journey and the investment. We get the privilege in this day, in this moment, as part of a Door Church family to say, we love the work of God within you, but there's been nurture and development all throughout the years, which we honor and want to say thank you to Jesus for. But it's brought you to a point where God wants to fill your life and with purpose, with destiny, with significance, with favor, that goodness and mercy to be right on your shoulders, chasing you down, that you may dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So let's just take a moment to be still as Jamal prepares his heart, as we prepare this room for this moment of confession, of testimony, of declaration, of commitment to the man, Jesus Christ, to following him, to following his leadership. So come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit.
Jamal, on profession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
some moments to linger and to affirm and to cherish the work of the Holy Spirit. Join with me for a moment, just extend a hand towards Jamal. Now let's pray for seeds of faith to be planted in his heart this day. That from heaven, seeds of faith would be planted into his heart, into his spirit, that will be germinated by the life-giving water of the Holy Spirit. And we're praying for breakthrough. We're praying for a breaking through of the ground of the purposes of God in you, Jamal. For what emerges to grow strong and have capacity for great fruit bearing. He has said that we are appointed to bear fruit, good fruit, fruit that will last. So Lord, fill him. Fill him, we pray. So I'm going to encourage you, if you sense God's given you a word or encouragement to share with Jamal after the service. We're going to turn now to worship and just to surround this moment just with just loving Jesus and loving him, loving his presence. But we can allow ourselves a moment for another round of applause, celebration. Well done, Jamal.
Every breath that I am made. Oh,
give another shout for the Lord? We love you, Jesus. You are good and you are alive and you are worthy. You are good and you are alive and you are worthy. And in the spirit of celebrating Him, we're going to sing another song. We're going to sing straight to Him. We're going to finish on one more song. Before that, I want to just drop some reminders in your brain. So Tuesday, we're going to be here worshiping, ministering to Him. Wednesday, we're going to be here watching The Chosen. And then in a few weeks, we're going to be together for Christian Concern. So let them trickle into your brains, ping your reminders. And now should we offer Him this final gift? It's our last chance to sing to Him together this morning. So if you've not yet joined us at the front, if you've not changed your posture, I invite you to do so as the team leaders in this. And we're going to lift Him up. We're going to lift Him higher. We're going to put Him right at the top of the priority list. We're going to declare to Jesus, the living God, that He is the living God. It sounds simple, sounds kind of counterintuitive to tell Him that, but it's who He is. And we want to agree with who He is, declare who He is over our lives, over our cities. So Jesus, we crown You right now. We honor You as the One who died and the One who came back. You laid down Your life and You picked it back up again. You picked it back up again. Oh gosh, Jesus, You are a real man and we love You. We crown You this morning, Jesus. Receive from us our offering as we sing to You, Lord. Thank you. Jesus, for the willingness and the obedience of your suffering, Jesus, thank you. Thank you. Just across the room, just use your voice. Just tell him thank you for that. Thank you that you died. Thank you for your surrender. Thank you for your obedience. Thank you that you bled for me. Thank you that you rose again, Jesus. Thank you that you are alive today. Thank you that you choose to move in this place. Thank you that your presence sustains us. Thank you, Jesus, that we are sprinkled by your blood and washed clean and raised up to your right hand, God, that we sit alongside you in eternal life. We thank you, Jesus, and we honor him. We honor him. We honor him. We honor you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Guys, if you've got need in your body, in your lives, if you need someone to come alongside you and pray, now is the time. We're going to keep this worship flow going. Just make your way forward, make yourself known. We'd love to come and pray alongside you. If that's not you, then we'd also love to fellowship with you, to share our stories with one another, to hang out for coffee, to celebrate Jamal's new life. Go and reintroduce yourself to Jamal after service today. We bless you guys. Hope you enjoy the rest of your Resurrection Sunday, celebrating him however you might be. We love you guys. And we love him more, right? Amen. Amen and amen.